Small business hiring might feel like walking through a maze blindfolded, but not only is hiring great team members possible, it is actually life-changing for you as a business owner. Over the last 10 odd years, I've made all the mistakes in the book when it comes to hiring new team members. I've put together these 9 tips to help you to avoid making the mistakes that I made over these last 10 years. Now, I won't beat around the bush. These are simple, actionable insights that you could use to transform your recruitment and your profit potential as a small business. Ready? Let's dive in. I started my painful journey around team building and recruitment way back in 2013 when I just left the corporate world. And I did have some experience managing teams, and I had learned quite a bit about business through my CPA, and I'd learned a lot of theory through my MBA. But when it came to actual practical recruitment and retention, I really found myself out of my depth. You see, when you're hiring for your own business, it turns out there's a lot more at stake. It's not like you're working for another company where you're just managing a team. The people you bring into your team can make or break your business. When I started off, I would hire people based on their written responses and job ads. Big mistake. Some of them did have the skills, but they didn't have the right attitude. So if you hire well and carefully, you can save yourself a world of heartache. Now, these are 9 lessons I've learned to help you build a sustainable, profitable business. Ready? Lesson number 1, always be in hiring mode. Finding the right team members isn't a one and done affair. It took me years to learn this simple lesson. Being on the lookout for great quality members who are a good fit for your organization is an ongoing exercise. Now, this doesn't mean you go on a hiring frenzy and you recruit every person that looks like a good fit for your business. What it does mean is you're always on the lookout and you're building relationships with these people with a view to potentially hiring them down the track. Neil Patel shares some great ideas at the end of this video on how he builds his team on an ongoing basis. Point number 2, don't hire the first applicant that walks in the door. I've made this mistake more than once. You'd think I would have learned from the first time I did it, but it took me ages to learn this lesson. Always be on the lookout for great candidates, and you're more likely to find the right person at the right time and not be in a huge rush to find your ideal candidate when you actually need them most. Okay, point number 3, get clear on the skills you need, but go beyond just the skills. What do I mean by that? Getting the right person on board with the right skills is essential, but it's not enough. You need to hire people who have the right attitude. Hire people who are entrepreneurial and resourceful. I've lost count of the number of candidates that I've hired that were a great fit for the role in terms of skills, but were unwilling or unable to do anything outside of their job description. For a small business owner, this is a nightmare. Don't make the same mistake I did. Hire people who have a great can-do attitude. Now, sure, they have to have the right skills, but I would argue that having the right attitude and having a problem-solving approach to things is probably more important than just the skills. Here's a pro tip. Write a great job description that automatically filters out the tire kickers. And to do this, I'll explain a little bit later how you can use an Easter egg approach in your job description. Point number 4, test for skills and attitude on a project basis before you take them in as a permanent full-time employee. Once I make a commitment to somebody by bringing them into my team, I do my best to offer them a great working environment. And once I introduce them to the rest of my team, it is hard for the rest of the team to then make adjustments if things don't work out with that new person I've hired. So I'm very careful about bringing them into the business's infrastructure unless I've really vetted them first. So a great way to vet these new team members is to make sure they're the right fit for your culture, more on culture a little bit later, but also to make sure that they have the skills and approach the job with the right attitude. So they go above and beyond. Just remember, people can put up a great front in an hour-long interview, but it's a lot harder for them to sustain or to feign great attitudes and skills over the period of a project. So I would recommend hiring them on a trial basis before you bring them fully into your business. Tip number 5, understand that hiring needs effort. Have you ever heard the phrase, sweat more in practice, bleed less in battle? Well, that is very true when it comes to hiring. One of the biggest mistakes you can make is not put effort into getting the right person in for the right job for every single role. This means you hire people who are keen to learn and who aren't afraid of stepping outside their comfort zone or their area of expertise. For years, I glossed over the idea that hiring required effort. And what that meant was I ended up hiring people who may have had the right skills and looked great on paper, but when it came to going above and beyond and getting results in my business, I didn't get people with the right fit. So what was the end result? My business was a dumpster fire for a while. People with the right skills who didn't want to do the work and didn't want to go above and beyond to get the job done. They were only willing to stay in their lane and do what they were hired to do. Newsflash, if you work in a small business, it's all hands on deck. Working only in your specialty is reserved for large organizations. For example, if you hire somebody as a video editor, they might need to occasionally come up with some graphic design work or manage a project in ClickUp. Sure, you wouldn't ask them to write code, but to be a good team member, they wouldn't balk at the idea of learning it. And that's the point. Hiring people who are open-minded and willing to learn is absolutely critical. If you don't do this, it will come back and bite you. Now, keep in mind, this approach of hiring people who are open-minded and willing to go above and beyond applies more to small businesses than it does to larger organizations. Maybe large companies can get away with that approach, but we can't do it in small businesses. Tip number 6, understand that retention takes even more effort than hiring well. Once you've got the hiring process right, you've done the work to hire the best people and bring them into the team, the next step is to retain them. And this means building and sustaining a great organizational culture. What do I mean by that? An organization or business's culture refers to its values, its ideas, its principles, its unwritten rules, its norms that make the business what it is. If you don't get somebody in who vibes with those rules and those values and principles, it will cause all sorts of problems in your business. To provide a good working environment to everybody in your team, they need to feel challenged, but not overwhelmed. They need to feel supported in making decisions and be given a little bit of professional latitude and not micromanaged. They need to be given the resources to do their job and learn how to do it well, but not be left without any direction or guidance. All of these things require a great organizational culture. Your business culture is the key to helping you retain your employees and build a business that sustains itself. Number 7, confirm that they're a good fit culturally during interviews. Now, your organizational culture, as we said earlier, refers to the values, beliefs, attitudes, behaviors that make up a business. It's a shared understanding of how your business does things. You could think of it as the personality of your organization. Culture is normally discussed in larger companies, but in my opinion, it's as important, if not more important, in a small business. So integrity, honesty, accountability are things that you can interview for by asking questions like, can you give me an example of when you went above and beyond for a customer? And check for how specific their example is. Ask them some further questions about it. Make sure that they actually have really delivered a result and they feel passionately about how they delivered a result for the customer. You're looking not just for what they did, but how they communicate what they did. Another question you might ask is, can you share an instance where you made a mistake? How did you address it? What did you learn? Again, you're checking not just to see what the mistake was and how they addressed it, but how they show up while they're talking about the mistake they made and how they addressed it. You're looking for somebody who adopts an approach of forgiveness toward themselves, but also an attitude of learning. Step number 8, make sure you have a clear job description and use an Easter egg. Now, what's an Easter egg? I'll give you an example. Imagine you're putting in a job ad for a video editor. You give them all the basics, you give them the skills required, you give them the responsibilities, all that is laid out. But somewhere in the job ad, and make sure it's not too conspicuous, you say something like, be sure to use the words superstar video editor in the subject line of your application. Now, you'll be amazed at how many people don't do this. Which brings me to my 9th point, screen for detail orientation by checking to see if they did use the Easter egg you asked for, as discussed in the previous tip. You'll be amazed at how many people don't actually read the job description in full, either because they don't pay attention to detail or because they're not that interested in the job. And in both instances, you don't want that person working in your business long term. So maybe you bring them in as a freelancer or something, but I don't recommend hiring them. I don't even recommend interviewing them in most cases, because when you put out an application like I do on onlinejobs.ph, you get a gazillion applications. pro tip. I tend to hire people from the Philippines because over the last 10 years, I've learned that they are the best employees in terms of attitude, and they are honest by and large, and they are relatively easy to work with. Full disclosure, I am an affiliate for onlinejobs.ph. And if you'd like to know more about it, you can just go to productiveinsights.com/OJP. By the way, if you found this conversation useful, please do subscribe and like this video and share it with somebody else who might benefit. And remember, hiring and retaining great team members is not easy. It takes a lot of work, but not doing the work takes even more work, because you'll be undoing a lot of damage in your business over years and potentially putting your business at risk. Now, at the start of this video, I did tell you that I would share a special snippet from my conversation with Neil Patel, where he talked about his hiring strategies and how he's taken his business from zero to $100 million a year and is doing so profitably. So, as promised, here's Neil Patel. Tell me a little bit about your approach to hiring, because I think hiring is one of the most important skills when it comes to building a great company with a great culture, which also your press release said that one of the reasons you were voted for the Inc. Workplace thing for the second year in a row is because you have a good culture. So talk to us about hiring and culture.
I'm not the right person to talk to about culture. My co-founder does all that. Hiring, we use one simple strategy. We look to see who's worked for multiple of our competitors, because if they work for multiple competitors, they know your space. We look for people who stay there for a while, because that means they're loyal. And we look for people who've got promoted consistently at our competitors. So if you're hiring someone for a role that they've done in the past, and they've worked at your competitors, and they've continually got it promoted, that means other people found them valuable. See, when you interview people, people tend to bullshit. Did really well, and I drove this revenue, and I'm the best, and this is why this company was successful. The truth is usually somewhere in between of what they're saying and what the company says. And when you hire someone who's worked at your competition or multiple competitors, they've gone continually promoted at both places, it means other people found them to be valuable. Those are the people you typically want, because when they say they can do something, usually they can, or else they wouldn't be continually promoted. That's a strategy to hire. Hit them up on LinkedIn. And we don't ever say, hey, Ash, love what you're doing. We want to hire you. That we found that doesn't work. We'll be like, hey, Ash, love what you've done in Australia at this ad agency. Assuming, you know, we're hiring you to run an ad agency in Australia. We're actually looking for someone just like you who has your skill set. Do you know anyone who would be a great fit? And that's it. And then a lot of times you, Ash, will be like, actually, I'm interested. Say, come work for us. We found that to be too direct and not work as well.
That also applies very well to sales, right? Because when you say to somebody, I'm looking for some, I have a membership program, for example, I often reach out and say, I'm looking to get other members just like you, because similar to a company, I think if you want to build a great membership, and I've got some really great members in my membership program, you got to handpick the people and you got to build a good culture. You got to bring the right members in, because one crappy member can just poison the well. So that's a great way to ask them if they know other people like them. And it's a very nice, non-invasive way to recruit members, as it were.
Yes.
I didn't know you had a co-founder. I assumed you were the only founder of NP Digital.
I own the majority of the company by far. And I have a co-founder. His name is Mike. Amazing guy. Has done extremely well in operations. Great background for recruiting and sales. And then funny enough, my CEO is also named Mike.
So there you have it. Neil Patel's take on hiring. That brings us to the end of this episode. You've got 9 specific tips you can use to learn how to onboard and retain great team members and grow your business profitably and build a great culture. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Share this video with somebody else who would benefit from it. And if you're interested in learning about other strategies around how to grow your business, check out the expert interviews playlist in this YouTube channel. I think you'll find it really useful. We've had experts like Seth Godin, Guy Kawasaki, Neil Patel's been on 3 times, Rand Fishkin, Sonia Simone, Victoria Labam, James Clear, and we would love for you to share it with other people who might benefit. Leave some comments underneath the video so it gets picked up by the YouTube algorithm and more people can see it. Be sure to check out the Productive Insights website, where you can find all these 9 tips detailed in writing on our blog. So just head over to productiveinsights.com and look for small business hiring. Thanks for listening, and I'll see you in the next video.